is the topic is mentioned in the abstract, I think, about Professor Khandokar Mukaddam Hussain, Provost Chancellor of Bangladesh Open University, is an eminent sociologist who marked his contribution to different fields of sociology of education, disaster management, and diaspora through his research and innovative initiative. Professor Hussain was a brilliant student throughout his student life and scored first classes in all his university and pre-university exams. He did his PhD degree in 1996 from Massey University under New Zealand Government MERT Fellowship, where he researched on disaster management issues
and contemplated to give his acquired knowledge into an institutional shape. In line with this, Professor Hussain proposed the authority of Dhaka University, where he worked for long as a professor of sociology, to form an institute on disaster and vulnerability studies, and the university responded, and he became the founding director of the institute. Professor Hussain is very enterprising and leads number of research projects on disaster management, sociology of diaspora and education. In this way, he became a lead researcher as well as education manager in the country Bangladesh. In 2013, Government of Bangladesh deputized him as Provice Chancellor of Bangladesh Open University for 4 years and got extension for second tenure of his successful educational management capability. Professor Hussain, in his long teaching career, did 50 plus keynote address in national and international seminar, conference and workshop, supervised 20 plus PhD and master student, and published 80 plus research article in different reputed journal in the field of sociology, disaster management of and education. He provided consultancy services for World Bank, British Council, UNDP, EU, and for many national and international NGOs. Currently, he concentrated on technology-mediated education, particularly ICT-enabled distance education. Recently, he has been the chief patron of BOU e-learning center. His drive on OER-enabled blended learning at the Bangladesh Open University has been praiseworthy and implemented number of project of OER issues with the Commonwealth of Learning. Professor Hussain has been popular discussant of the TV talk show in Bangladesh on HIV/AIDS disaster, sociology of diaspora in Indian subcontinent, particularly in partition of 1947, liberation war of Bangladesh, and Rohingya issues and social sciences issues of in the country. He traveled 30 plus countries for academic purpose and has been a significant name in the field of sociology, vulnerability studies, and open and distance learning. So I'd like to request Professor Khandokar Mukaddam Hussain to deliver his fifth lecture of our ongoing partition lecture series. Thank you.
So today we'd like to discuss about this particular topic, the dilemma of diaspora in the context of the Bengal partition, refugee politics, and over military. Basically, what I am trying to do in this particular paper, so what happened with this particular paper, scholars of Bangladesh and India, what they have said, starting with the historian, then social scientists, writers, novelists, poets, filmmakers, social reformers, on Indian partition, especially the Bengal partition, and its aftermath with the special focus on women's vulnerability. Well, diaspora, it's a dilemma, no doubt about that. And this particular dilemma has its own construction in the context of social, economic, political, cultural, psychological, biological, sexual, and mental situation. The researcher has significantly highlighted on the Bengal partition, women sufferings, killings, torture, abduction, forced marriage, conversion, subjugation, confinement, exclusion, in the context of their social, cultural, religious, psychological, mental, sexual, biological, health, nutrition, empowerment, and political and communal and economic perspective, as highlighted by different authors, researchers, writers, filmmakers, story writers, and poets. This study has followed an interdisciplinary approach
combining the historical, sociological, political, economic, cultural, religious and anthropological in the context of politics, partition, migration, gender and diaspora. Although this is a very complex dimension actually. So many things coming together. You see, diaspora, it is very much in the context of, while we are talking about the Bengal partition is a vast area to explore actually. So many dimensions of Bengal partition, and Bengal partition again divided into two situations, 1905 and 1947. So two different diasporic situations has been developed. It is not the diasporic situation. In 1905, the situation was very much part of the political implicated, and it was never ever implemented actually. But this particular situation has created a lot of negative impacts and implication in the context of communality, in the context of religious harmony, and in the context of ethnic and nationality. So this particular situation is also one of the areas to be considered in the context of diasporic situation, because this is the preamble situation that has been set up in the context of 1947 diaspora. This is the background situation that has been developed, and it was developed by the British people, and they wanted to take the advantages in the context of this particular divide and rule policy, and they wanted to rule this particular country by divided this particular harmonic situation between the different nationalities, ethnicity, religious groups. And one thing we need to clarify actually, before British people came in this particular country, this particular country, the greater India, was not prosperous in the context of poverty, famine, malnutrition, hunger and other situation. But one thing was very much prevalent, that is the communal harmony. It's hundreds and thousands of years this particular people of different, having the different background, they are very much having the coexistence with this particular unique harmony and cooperation among and between themselves. So that was the big thing that happened before the British Raj came in this particular country. British regime again divided into two situations, you know all about this. The East Indian Company, they took over in 1600 and they ruled almost 150 years, and then the British Raj took over. The nature of exploitation, the nature of subjugation, the nature of drain out of resources, the nature how they made this particular people slaves and other situation, those also created a lot of challenges in this particular Indian subcontinent. And as a consequence, when the Congress was coming forward with all these particular issues, the leadership was very strong initially, but later on we could see within this particular Congress there are a lot of challenging situation that arose. In the meantime, Congress bifurcated and Muslim League constituted. And that was another turning point, unfortunately, and that situation created the different agenda, and religiosity and this particular so-called Muslim identity, these two things actually was capitalized by the so-called leaders of the then Muslim League. And that was another catastrophe that happened in this particular Greater Bengal, unfortunately. And the later situation, you know all about this, the how this particular Bengal was divided, I am not going to discuss all about this because it is the historical background and most of you are very much known and familiar to this particular situation. But what I am trying to say that when this particular British representatives use this particular British trump card to divert people's attention from freedom of revolution, so it has the political background, different political background. Why the British people did it? They did it because of this particular, they got one thing in their mind that this particular Bengali people are having the extraordinary leadership capacity. And because of that particular capacity, once this India cannot be kept in their hand. So that was the big challenge actually for the British Raj. And that's why they were very much desperate in dividing this particular Bengal actually. And once this particular Bengal was divided, it became part of this kind of nation state situation. Distinct antagonistic situation that was developed, and sharp political bifurcation, and Hindu-Muslim community was divided forever. And this particular paper has also consulted the number of eminent researchers' work. Those who worked in India, Pakistan and Bangladesh on the diaspora, Bengal partition, politics, and political economy of this particular Bengal partition. So among them, Urvashi Butalia, the book Other Side of Silence, Ritu Menon, Borders and Boundaries, Kamala Bhasin, The Borders and Boundaries, then Pritam Pinjor, Monto, a famous film director, Kartar Singh, Abducted Not, Subhash Ghosh, Devjani Dotto, Jashodhara Bakchi, and many others of West Bengal. In Bangladesh, Kaiser Haq, he is a story writer, he has written a story on border. Hassan Azizul Haq, he has written a particular book on Heart and Home, and Agun Paki, Soed Waliullah, The Escape, Ekti Tulsi Gasser Kahini. If we just analyze this particular Ekti Tulsi Gasser Kahini, then we could see how this particular communal violent situation was very much volatile situation when this particular Muslim family was migrated from West Bengal to Bangladesh, and they just forcibly occupied a particular Hindu house, and that particular Hindu house got one tulsi gas, and that is the sacred symbol of sacredness for the Hindu family. You know all about it. So this particular family was firmly decided to uproot that particular plant, but one member of that particular family, he had some sort of reservation. He said that this particular tulsi can be treated as a medicinal ingredient. I got some cold, so I can be treated with this particular tulsi pata. What he was trying to do, he was trying to save this particular plant as part of the sacredness, but he was just diverting the situation in a different way. So if you analyze this particular fact, then you could see the attitude of the people, the Muslim people, towards the Hindu people who are forced to migrate from the Bengal part to elsewhere of either West Bengal or Assam or Tripura, like that actually. So this is a very simple incident, but this particular simple incident can tell you the what kind of communal grievances that developed during this particular Bengal partition, unfortunately. So this is the one example actually. Tosliman Astin, Ferrari. She has written one book on Ferrari, and she has also identified how the root was uprooted. So this is a long episode actually, and this particular episode is also subject to further research, further explanation, and further investigation actually. So many works have been done by other writers and also the prominent Bengali authors, sociologists, and other social scientists. Akhtarujjaman Ilyas and Politics of Diaspora Dilemma, written by Abu Rash, and Vishwajit Ghosh, The Side, This Side and That Side. So these are some of the works of Bangladeshi authors and writers. Sardar Joynendi, Onek Surer Asha, Onek Surjer Asha. Then Ranga Prabhat, written by Abul Fazl. And Alauddin Al Azad, Khuda O Asha. So these are some of the areas to be analyzed further actually. Basically, this paper is an overview paper actually. I have tried to unearth the root causes of Bengal partition and those who are very much involved in this particular process of analysis. This particular analysis, what happened actually, let me say frankly, so each and every discipline got different dimensions, different perspective, different theoretical framework and approaches. But this particular type of research, especially the diasporic research, must be part of interdisciplinary approach. So one missing agenda is this particular approach and this particular lack of interdisciplinary situation. So once this particular university has introduced this particular lecture series, so what would be my humble submission, that please do follow this particular interdisciplinary approach and bring all the literature together, find the gap in between, and then go for the field to unearth the ground realities with some of the case studies or key informants interview or some kind of retrospective memories of some old people who are still alive in both Bengal. So if I write a particular episode in the context of West Bengal, being an author, and if I write a particular episode on diaspora, being an author of East Bengal, so it would be different to some extent, because the most important thing is that we are the human being, we are not above the value situation. So this kind of particular sensitive issue must be value free, and once we are having this particular value free environment and methodological framework, only then we would be able to have the better research in this particular area. Otherwise, there are hundreds and thousands of research that have been carried out in both of the Bengal, including the West Pakistan, which is Pakistan now, including of course Punjab. But lack of synchronization, lack of coordination, and lack of authentic information, and lack of ground realities, these particular studies are having that different dilemma in the context of diasporic research and other situation actually. Now my question is, why are diaspora treated as dilemma? That is my question. So this is the process of disintegration, nothing else actually. Disintegration of what? This is the disintegration of ethnicity, nationality, races, religious identities, minorities, caste, social classes, and creeds, for whom the space of habitation of homeland is always linked to the space of absence, forced migration, either through colonial subjugation or partition, or even political implications of creating an imaginary homeland, leaving behind the original homeland. So diaspora is a myth, at the same time diaspora is also a reality. Two things coming together. But what are the background situation actually? It is one kind of complex formations in a hope to form a particular so-called nation state. And this particular nation state must be based on so-called religiosity or ethnicity or nationality. That is the big challenge. And this particular religiosity is very much part of the political implication, nothing else actually. And it is also the process of excluding a particular ethnic group of people or religious background people from their homeland. So that's why this particular research also tried to overview the state role and responsibility, how the British Raj played this particular devastating games, and how this particular partition devastated millions of strong Indian people who became part of this kind of so-called diasporic situation, unfortunately. Diaspora is also part of the historically separated diaspora. There are two situations here. One is old Indian diaspora, or that is called the exclusivism, and the new Indian diaspora, that is the border situation. Now, diaspora and diaspora communities are two things need to be treated as part of this kind of forced to leave their homeland and migrated to the neighboring countries, or had to take shelter in the border adjacent geographic and territorial area where different ethnic and religious migrant groups are forced to stay as refugees. Now, while we are talking about this particular diaspora, then the question of refugee. Now, who are refugee actually? We know all about this. When the Bengal partition happened, and because of 1947 situation, it was 15 to 25 million people, they were part of this kind of forced migration, and most of them became part of this particular refugee situation. And refugee, the word refugee itself is part of the reflection of pathetic situation actually. So refugees are the most neglected and they are not recognized by any particular nation state or the main nationality or ethnic group of people. So refugee group people do not have any identity. Well, how this particular refugee people tried hard and struggled hard to be part of this kind of mainstream Indian citizenship or nationalities or Pakistani citizenship or nationalities. That's a long episode actually. We need to carry the further research in this particular context. It's a huge area to be unearthed actually. Now Bengal partition, the first situation what happened actually in Bengal partition, the Mughal Empire lost its power in the region, you know all about it, and the Bengal was caught in the rivalry between British and the French for trade with the India. Basically the Western people, they came here for the trade, commerce and business, no doubt about that. But once they got this particular control over this particular trade, they took the political control. So the political economy of British rule in India, if we just analyze this particular fact, had two distinct objectives. Karl Marx has vividly explained about this particular situation. He said the impact of political economy of British Raj in India had two objectives and two impacts and implications that happened here. One was very much destructive and degenerative, and another was very much positive and productive. So destructive and degenerative, they devastated our self-sufficient economy, political institutions and the communal harmony. And this particular so-called positive regenerative things are because of the English education and the because of the communication network. The communication network, especially the railway network, objective was not positive and productive. It was also again the exploitative. Just how to drain out all the resources and how to extract this particular resources from the remote most area of all India, and then how to drain it out to this particular offshore of England. That was the purpose, but that helped a lot after 1947. But otherwise, the British people's role and responsibility, if we analyze from the historical perspective, was always exploitative. And not only that, the creation of nation state of Pakistan and India, that had not only the devastating effect on the economy and productivity of this particular country, the whole mass people of this particular two regions were divided mentally, socially, politically, culturally, psychologically and religiously. That was the another situation actually. The 1905 partition left considerable minorities of Hindus in East Bengal and Muslims in West Bengal. While the Muslims were in favor of the partition, as they would have their own province and homeland, Hindus were not. This controversy led the increase of violence and protest, and finally in 1911, the two provinces were once again united. However, the plan directly ran counter to the Muslim League's, which demanded the creation of a separate Muslim homeland on the basis of the two-nation theory. And this particular two-nation theory, again, it was the devastating situation, and it devastated the whole united India, unfortunately. And Bengal provincial Muslim League leadership opinion was in favor of this particular division, strong support for this particular division. But Muhammad Ali Jinnah realized the validity of Sohrawardi's argument and gave his tactic support to the plan. Now, Sohrawardi and Subhash Bose brother, they were in favor of this particular Bengal partition. Yes, Sharad Bose. These two persons are very strongly in favor of this particular situation. But Jinnah tactfully, he didn't want it actually. And that's why he was in the line of the Congress leaders. But the things didn't work the way they wanted actually. After Jinnah's approval, Sohrawardi shared gathering support to materialize his own plan. On the Congress side, only a handful of leaders agreed to the plan. Among them was the influential Bengal Provincial Congress leader Sharat Chandra Bose, the elder brother of Netaji, and the Kiran Shankar Roy. However, the most of the BPCC leaders and Congress leadership, including Nehru and Patel, rejected this particular plan. In fact, the colonial ruler divided the Bengal in communal lines into two provinces, no exception actually. And the objective of first partition was to maintain the colonial control, to weaken the anti-colonial nationalistic movement, dividing the Bengali both geographically and communally, dividing Bengali, and objective was failed, but this particular objective was grossly failed due to mount storm of protest and was annulled in December 1911. Now, the obvious reasons of Bengal partition of 1947, the Calcutta killing of August 16 of 1946, it was a brutal bloodbath and civil disorder, unfortunately. At least 10,000 people have brutally been killed. Almost 15,000 were severely injured. And there are thousands of tragic and violent incidents that spread in both parts of Bengal. The riots and violence made realize the British rulers to take some immediate measures, otherwise they might lose their control over India. On the other hand, the top leaders of both Congress and Muslim League became worried over unruly and violent incidents. Now, the division of India on the basis of two-nation theory almost certainly resulted in the partition of the Bengal province among religious lines. Bengal Provincial Muslim League leader Sorardi had a new plan to create an independent Bengal state that would join neither Pakistan nor India and remain unpartitioned. Sorardi realized that if Bengal was partitioned, it would be economically disastrous for East Bengal, as all coal mines and all jute mills except a few industrial plants would remain to the west part, which is controlled by the Hindu majority nationalities. Moreover, Calcutta is the largest hub of commercial and capital city of India, would also go to the western part. Sorardi floated his idea on 24th April 1947, a press conference in Delhi. In the meantime, the nationalistic party Hindu Mahasabha, under its leadership, vehemently opposed this particular partition. But a politics of Sorardi helped to have the partition accordingly. Muslim League was also succeeded to their two-nation propaganda theory by materializing this particular Sorardi plan, with the marginalization of Hindus in the Sorardi ministry and the barbaric riots of 1946, the Muslim administrator lost her trust among Bengali Hindus. Soon afterwards, division arose among Bose and Sorardi on the question of the nature of electorates and separate or joint. So this was again the division actually between Sorardi and Bose. Due to the constant diplomatic efforts of Sorardi and Muslim League's radical stand on for maintaining the separate electorate for Muslim and non-Muslims, Redcliffe line was drawn, which was basically the religious demographics, unfortunately. You see, the red point I have mentioned, the religious demographics. So this is another harsh reality that happened in this particular context of this particular Bengal partition. However, Bose vehemently opposed to this, he withdrew, but due to lack of any other significant support from the Congress side, the United Bengal plan was discarded. So how Bengal was divided actually? You see, the majority Muslim districts, I am not mentioning the districts, you could see in the red marked situation, non-Muslim districts and the Muslim districts. And final division happened. Pakistan got East Dinajpur, Rangpur, Rajshahi, Bogra, Pabna, Mamsingh, and India got West Dinajpur, Jalpaiguri, Darjeeling, Malda, Murshidabad, West Nodia, Calcutta, Chobbish Porgona, Bardhaman, Birbhum, Medinapur, Howrah, Hugli, and Barak Valley in Assam. Now, the question is that what happened after this particular partition or the aftermath of the second partition of Bengal? Well, violence was erupted to any extent, riot and forced leaving of millions of Hindus and Muslims and Sikhs from their homelands. As Bashabi said, there is the reality of the continuous flow of economic migrants, refugees or infiltrators, illegal immigrants who cross over the border and pan out across the subcontinent looking for work, for new home, setting in metropolitan centers. And the after effect of the partition was horrific and beyond narration. This was an outflow of the target of minorities due to the ethnic cleansing, forced migration, religious conversion, and death. It is not only the question of ethnic cleansing, rather it was forced migration, forced conversion, religious conversion, and also the brutal killings. And also the influx of religious migrants from across the border also erupted tragic communal violence on and off, and civil wars occurred between the neighboring countries. Mistrust that developed and border became insecure. Both Hindus in East Bengal and Muslims in West Bengal became unsafe and insecure as communal violence and conflict erupted. And the high caste Hindus, including the educated urban upper class, the rural gentry, traders, businessmen, artisans of East Bengal left for the India first, especially the different parts of West Bengal, and were able to settle with less challenges. So for upper caste Hindu, those who migrated from the East Pakistan to different part of West Bengal, they didn't have any major problem because they had their own resources to back up. But the reality is that what they left behind their most valuable ancestral land, their relations, the emotional and sentimental relationship with their close kins, and also the harmonic relationship with the Muslim neighbors. So this could not possible to get back actually. So it is not like that they are not in challenge, they had also their challenges. And this particular area also needs to have further investigation for research actually. But those who are the scheduled caste Hindus who migrated from East Pakistan to different parts of West Bengal, they were actually part of this kind of miserable situation actually. The nature of vulnerability, it is again beyond narration actually. So poverty, malnutrition, hunger, shelterless situation, and also lack of resources that really made them not only refugee, that made them really vulnerable and destitute. If we just use these two words, one is vulnerability and another is destitute, these two words might have the farthest implications and also need to have the further research and investigations actually. Only two words can have the huge area and scope of research, further research actually. But interestingly, some of the Hindus, they remained in East Pakistan. Now, why they remained in East Pakistan, that is also another question mark. Apparently, we say because they didn't have any option to go, or because of the future uncertainty, they didn't take that particular risk. Whether it is only the uncertainty and risk or something else, it is again part of this kind of emotional situation, psychological affinity and strong resentment about leaving their homeland. Homeland, sweet home, just the word sweet home, if you analyze this particular fact, again this particular situation needs further explanation, no exception actually. Anyway, the next 2 decades, Hindu forced to leave East Pakistan due to sudden eruption of communal violence and tensions and further deterioration in 1964 and 1965. The 1951 population census, India recorded 2.5 million refugees from East Bengal, whereas 1961 population census of Pakistan recorded about 0.67 million refugees in East Bengal, mostly migrated from different parts of West Bengal and Bihar. In 1961, about 0.8 million Muslim migrated from West Bengal and Bihar to East Pakistan. But according to the research findings of IR, the cost of Indian partition was as follows. About 17.9 million had to leave their homes. The number of killings was within the range of almost 200,000. The number of missing people was about 3.4 million. And the violent nature of the partition created an atmosphere of hostility and suspicion between state level and of India and Pakistan, and that plagues their negative relationship till date. The social impacts on both Bengal and East Pakistan of the partition. Well, it was the refugee camps and colonies, mushroom of refugee camps. It's like a mushroom, like anything actually, unfortunately, and the colonies. And till today we are having the colonies actually. There are many colonies. If you go to Rajshahi, then there is a colony in North Bengal that is called Malda colony. Hundreds and thousands of people, they are confined in that particular colony. And their living standard, I personally visited that particular place. And I also visited the Murshidabad colony. The Muslim who migrated and the Hindus who migrated, unbelievable sufferings. The way they are living, it is not the standard of living quality at all in the Indian context, especially in the context of macro level development scenario of modern India. It is unthinkable, unimaginary, and beyond narration. I myself visited their camp. And last 2-3 days, I was just moving around India. I asked about this particular diasporic situation in this particular Calcutta region. So, most of the people, they are the migrant people, unfortunately. And I've been in Bagdora yesterday night. I was just in a shopping complex and I was asking, they were rather asking me, where are you from? Because I got the different identity actually. I'm from Bangladesh. And then the answer was that we are also from Bangladesh. But how they came to this particular part and what was the aftermath situation, it needs further study actually. So there are hundreds and thousands of people in and around of Calcutta and other part of West Bengal. Their forefathers are here, but their generation after generation, they are having one thing in their mind. They had the root in Bangladesh. So this is the psychological construction again actually. Now why this particular psychological construction? What's the reason of this kind of strong affinity till today? And these particular people are becoming emotional seeing us actually. Why? I got the different religious background, I got the different identity. But still why they are having or showing every eagerness to have some kind of solidarity and affinity. That is another area. So psychological construction of this particular partition and its aftermath situation, it's a missing agenda in most of the literatures. What I have searched so far actually. So this is another area to be ventured by the researchers. And my honest submission would be to Professor Menon that please keep in mind in this particular area actually. So emotion and expectation, it never can be wiped up actually. So there are many episodes of political economy of the episode of this particular Bengal partition was, just take the example of tea. So teas are mostly planted in this particular West Bengal, especially the Siliguri and Darjeeling area. But auction held in Chittagong port, and most of the teas were used to go to the European country through Chittagong port. And this particular Assam, Tripura and that particular area, Meghalaya area, whole teas used to come to Chittagong port. And then it was auctioned and processed. Once this particular Bengal partition happened, so producers lost their connectivity, market network. And let's give another example of jute. Jutes are normally produced in East Bengal, but most of the jute industries are set up in West Bengal. You see what kind of negative and devastating economic impact happened between these two particular Bengal. And who are the jute producers and who are the jute workers? Hundreds and thousands of workers, they became unemployed within a couple of nights. No exception. And border area, what happened? Smuggling just started and it was never ending. As a consequence, after effect of smuggling, inflation, deprivation of getting revenue by the government. Two things come together. And also the risk and also the social pathology. Four things came together actually. So there are many things, there are many gaps in between actually. We need to identify and unearth all those things actually. Now, in West Bengal, another social problem erupted because of this particular migration. The rivalry situation erupted between the refugee and the Ghotis. You know about it better than, because I didn't work in this particular area. So how it happened, and it had the long consequences. This is another area to identify the, by the researchers. And population migration also created imbalanced situation in the context of literature. So Bengal is rich because not of the resources. Bengal is rich because of this particular literary background actually. And undivided Bengal was very much part of this kind of nature of richness, nature of comprehensiveness, and nature of uniqueness. These three things totally devastated actually. Whether it is part of the missing link nowadays or not, that up to you, sir. You know better than, you are the most senior citizen here actually. Whether we are able to re-establish this particular link, I don't think so. I don't think so. We are having the Upper Bangla, Upper Bangla. We are having many emotional episodes. After liberation of war, or during the war of liberation, we are having many writings by both the scholars of both Bengal side. But to what extent we are united, that is a big question mark. Ekushe Boimela happened in Kolkata, but in a separate way. Why not with the Indian Ekushe Boimela together? The Porshimonga Rajya Porshad, the way they are organizing this particular Boimela, why not Ekushe Boimela is part of that particular situation? That is my question actually. What's the division? Why this division? Why this bifurcation? Should not be happened. But it's happening in practice and in reality. Anyway. Now, another important episode, I do not know whether it has been addressed by the researchers in the context of interdisciplinary perspective, that is the trauma, anxiety, stress and strain. These four things, it cannot be measured in your open eye. Even if you put the Likert scale of measurement, it cannot be measured, I tell you one thing. How the women and girls are traumatized, how the oldest people are traumatized, how the disabled people are traumatized, I don't know whether any particular work on disability and partition. Do you have any idea? I don't think we have. 10% of people are disabled in both Bangla. It's a significant number of people migrated, disabled people. How they survived, whether at all they are able to survive or not, or subsist or not. We don't think about those particular group of people actually. So this is another area. And trauma is many dimensions of trauma actually. A particular woman who has been violently raped or gang raped, she got one type of trauma. A woman who lost her homeland, another type of trauma. A woman who lost her social networking, another type of trauma. A woman who lost her close kin or own son or daughter, another type of trauma. A particular family who lost their means of livelihood, that is another type of trauma. There are many types of trauma actually. So we need to measure all these particular things. Now, Pakistani got one type of mythology and India got another type of mythology. This mythology was, Pakistani mythology was fulfilled by Muslim, would always remain as oppressed minority if India ruled by Hindus. This is a mindset situation actually, I tell you. Now, most of the Pakistani people had this kind of mentality. Why? The Bengali people didn't have this kind of mentality, but the Pakistani leaders had this kind of mentality. Why this kind of mentality? Needs further research. And on the another hand, the Indian mythology was the partition is the inevitable outcome of skimming and ever increasing demand of Muslim nation state. This was another mythology from the Indians' mindset situation. So these two mythologies can also be researched further. Anyway, now I would like to highlight about this particular women's issue. Women's issue, why this particular agony? Because the women who became the victim of this particular situation, either she been violated or been exploited otherwise, her own family denied to accept her. It happened in both Hindu and both Muslim situation. Why it happened? This particular vulnerable group of women, they didn't have any place in their family, unfortunately. Many of them were forced to be part of abandoned situation only because of the family and so-called construction. Construction of what? Why this kind of honor killing among and between the women? Why the group suicidal situation happened with the women? Jump into a particular oil or many oils. Why this particular situation happened? So there are many episodes, unfortunately, and many untold situation needs to be further researched and investigated. This is another area. And patriarchal construction, why not it has been changed? Critical moment of the crisis. It is the just climax of crisis. At that particular time, you are having the strong patriarchal construction. Why not you are coming out of this particular psychological construction or political construction or religious construction? This particular patriarchal construction needs to be further researched actually. Now, disempowerment of women. Many women who were supporting in agricultural productivity in both of the Bengal, once they were uprooted, they lost everything and they were unable to assist their family and they were becoming part of this kind of refugee status, you know all about it. And some women are denied the essential services of food, shelter and security at refugee camps. So, gender is a construction. Humayun Azad of Bangladesh, he has written a classic book, Titiyo Lingo. In Mohanagar and Epar Ganga, Opar Ganga, so Satyajit Ray, Madhubi Mukherjee and Jyotirmay Devi discussed about the nature of barbaric oppression of women. Isaac Chakler's story, that is short history, reflects the pervasiveness of oppression on women. Somaresh Basu, the women who sold wires in another episode of women's repression and brutality. Just you are selling out the women like a commodity. Unusha Sengupta, looking back at partition and women is another classic episode, reflected women's subjugation, but needs further research actually. Joshoroma Baxi's Trauma and the Tramp, only a single boy on trauma, but is mostly on Punjab episode actually. Meghedhaka Tarao of Shaktipada Rajguru is another account of refugees' vulnerability, of course reflected women's sufferings and co-sufferings. Ritik Ghatak's film highlighted the crisis of losing one's homeland and the pangs of ruthless episode of refugee life. That is a movie actually. But movie got its own reality too. Women were direct victims of direct action riots in Calcutta and Noakhali violence. Now these so-called direct action riots, another dark area, needs to further research actually. Anti-women violence occurred in 1947, massacres of Muslims in Bihar. Research findings show that some instances there were many armed warriors of different religious groups and sects who abducted, raped and confined many women of other religious sects and ethnic communities. This is the harsh, another reality actually. Regarding the abduction of women, Leonard said Indian government estimated about 33,000 Hindu and Sikh women and Pakistan government estimated about 50,000 Pakistani women were abducted. What happened with those particular 1 lakh abducted women? We do not know. That is a missing agenda. Needs further research actually. And many Hindu and Muslim families refused to take back the victim women in the name of defiled and impurity, so-called impurity. Is this the religious construction or only the mindset construction? Religion is not going to look into the situation. Why you are not in a position to change your mindset situation? You are denying your own blood relations or close kin, and you are denying their sufferings too. Why it's happening? Many women are refused to recover, fearing being shamed and rejected by their families. According to Bhutalia, sacrifice of women, children and families are beyond narration. It is the women who were raped and abducted. It is the women who became widowed. It is the families who sacrificed for national integrity. So sacrifice for what? Joya Chatterjee, the spoils of Pakistan, and Nilanjana Chatterjee's Calcutta, the living city, coming out the partition are two writings reflect women's sufferings in a convincing way. Women are becoming malnourished, undernourished, sick and frightening mentality of losing their home, belongings to their dear and close kins and including children. Honor killing, as I mentioned earlier, became frequent practices during that particular situation. It is the husband who killed their wives. You see, father who killed their daughters. Prevalence of preemptive suicide, that also increased, the suicidal situation. That is another situation. Now, women's vulnerability, I will take only 2 minutes actually. Apart from all this particular agony related to this women's sufferings, exploitation and violation, what happened actually? The women had many other role and responsibility to be shared at household level. While they were just migrated and became part of this kind of new situation and started with the new constructions of houses. So reconstructing all these particular houses, managing all this power, kind of household chores, and everything has to be done by the women. And this created another extra burden for the women folk after the partition situation. And once they are uprooted, they are not only uprooted, they lost their close social networking situation. And kin-based relationship was also very much disrupted. They were forced to exposure to outer world, and this rather helped them to become to some extent self-independent. This was a positive impact actually. And they had to struggle to establish their own identity, because most of them were suffering from identity crisis. And most important hegemony that happened in West Bengal actually, the Hindus, those who migrated from East Pakistan, who is upper caste Hindu, who is lower caste Hindu, who is untouchables, there was no way to separate this particular situation. All became part of this kind of refugee situation. And this is another area how they were struggling psychologically to cope with this particular new environment. This was a quite challenge actually. Anyway, the concluding remarks and policy implications. This paper has identified some burning issues relating to diaspora, partition, politics, refugees and gender vulnerability by reviewing some secondary literature and some content analysis. The area of research that has been identified by the esteemed faculties and researchers of Netaji Subhash Open University needs to venture further research from ground realities. Although it's quite challenging task, but by forming an interdisciplinary research team from both West Bengal and Bangladesh, the study can further carry out at grassroots level to unearth the realities. Although the NSOU has made a repository in this regard, it can also include the Bangladesh professionals so that they can extend big support to this regard. Especially the effective joint researches are needed to carry out in the context of women's vulnerability in a more comprehensive way. Some case studies, key informants interview and participant observation oriented research can be carried out jointly. Content analysis is another way to get most reliable information. Needs to judge the validity and reliability of existing research works. Value-free and ethically neutral research needs to be carried out jointly. Initiative to be needed to venture all the documentaries related to diaspora, politics, partition and communalities. Gender and women-specific research needs to be carried out further in a more focused way and in a more comprehensive way. Thank you so much for your patient hearings.